So I have to, I'm an academic, right? I'm not a religious man. I have to admit, I have a few problems with the Heart Sutra. Because the Heart Sutra is literally acceptable, but it has to be interpreted. And this is not explained quite well enough. Mostly people think, oh, form is emptiness, emptiness is form. But that is not the case. No Gay Luke Lama thinks that. Form is empty. That's true, because it has no inherent existence. But emptiness is a non-affirming negative and is not anything like form. Nothing at all like form. Emptiness is a mere absence of inherent existence. Form is materially established stuff. So the sutra needs to be interpreted. And that's not surprising, because the Buddha's sutras, the Buddha spoke different things to different people. Unlike most other philosophers, the Buddha could look into your heart, the tradition claims, and tell you what you needed to know. And so for some, form is emptiness. Emptiness is form, resounds, speaks to you. But really, there's a relationship between emptiness and form, specifically spelled out in the Madhyamaka text that the Gay Lukes love so much. And the relationship is one entity but different isolates. And an isolate is an isolatable factor that you can isolate by thought. So let's say you have a form, which is this cup. The cup is empty, there's no doubt about it. But the emptiness is the emptiness is the same entity as the cup. That is to say, it exists here with the cup. And if you break the cup, the emptiness of the cup will go away. But the relationship is not that straightforward, because the relationship between the emptiness and the form is called an isolate. So it's not the emptiness of the cup. And in that way, Gay Lukes love that kind of thing. And in that way, you can conceptually isolate the emptiness away from the cup. Nevertheless, the Heart Sutra is considered to be a definitive sutra, but it needs to be interpreted. Do not feel that emptiness is form. Today I want to talk about illusion, maya. The Sanskrit, usually I have a blackboard, but I'm going to try to get along without a blackboard today. I like to put Sanskrit words on the board. And maya, if you draw the Sanskrit characters, looks a little bit like the English word maya. And so it's fun to look at. Illusion. Tibetan Buddhists want to talk about a variety of different kinds of illusions. Some of them affect us in ways which are tremendously painful. And some of them are not that important. The Tibetans want to talk about four superficial causes of error that create illusion. And maybe you can give me better examples than these classical examples that they want to talk about. The first is the cause of the error is in the object. And that's, for instance, if you had a firebrand and you swung it around, it would appear to have a circle of fire, right? You know what I mean. We usually use sparklers, and we spin the sparklers, and the sparkler to the perceiver appears to be describing a full circle. This is an illusion. But it's not that important illusion, and the basis of the error is in the object here. Any other, can you think of any other
the color plate.
Oh, yes, seems to be a disc. Things like speed and things like that. How about movies? Maybe all videos are illusory. Definitely all videos are illusory, pardon me. And the cause of the error is in the basis. In the object, I'm sorry. The cause of error being in the basis is described as the basis being the eye power, usually. But it doesn't have to be the eye sense power. It could be one of the other sense powers that's screwed up. And then your illusion derives from the basis, whereas sometimes you see one moon as two moons. Have you ever done that? The Tibetans talk about it constantly. They were always seeing one moon as two moons. And also they describe ophthalmia, which is kind of like falling hairs in the eyes, which I think we call floaters. The Tibetans call them mosquitoes. That kind of thing is an illusion because it appears to be external to the eye, but it's in the eye. And you appear to have two moons if you're seeing that. Another one they want to talk about where there's just a superficial cause of error is a situation where, and I've seen this many times, especially on trains, I notice. I'll be sitting in a train, and the train will be stopped, and there'll be a train next to me. And that train will begin to move, and I will think I'm moving, or vice versa. Sometimes you're in a boat when that kind of illusion occurs. The trees moving and the boat standing still, that sort of thing happens all the time. It's an illusion. It's not that important. We readily learn about that. And we can ignore it somewhat. The last of these superficial causes of error leading to an illusion is what they call the immediately preceding condition, where you've gotten tremendously angry. The Tibetans love to talk about this, although I've never experienced it. You've gotten tremendously angry, and suddenly everything you see is red. Seeing red, the Tibetans love to talk about seeing, and Indian classical texts also mention it. Has that ever happened to you? Does that really happen? They think it happens. These superficial causes of error are also called facsimiles of direct perceivers. Facsimiles of direct perceivers. And I just mentioned them just to point out, just to soften the ground somewhat, because I'm going to be suggesting next that not only these four causes of error operate in our lives, but also just about everything we see around us, we see incorrectly. It's an illusion. In general, illusions can have two aspects. One is a superimposition of something that doesn't exist onto reality. And the other is a deprecation, taking away something that does exist away from reality. Usually the former is our problem. Today I want to talk a little bit about this marvelous book that my old Sanskrit professor, Karen Lang, has written. It's many years ago, actually. It's called The Four Illusions, and it's Chandrakirti's commentary on Aryadeva's 400. And Aryadeva, perhaps you know these two philosophers from the 2nd, 3rd, 4th century. It's hard to say exactly. Madhyamaka philosophers. Aryadeva and Chandrakirti both are considered to be not just Madhyamaka philosophers, but Prasangika Madhyamaka philosophers, which makes them, in the Central Asian Buddhist world, that makes them at the very top of the philosophical heap. prasangika. And for the most part, Gelug Buddhism in Tibet and now in India, their ontological view is based on Chandrakirti. And for the most part, Aryadeva. Karen Lang, a great, great scholar, beautiful person. She lives in Seattle now. We should invite her down here. So, I first read this book a while back, and I had seen a Simpsons episode in which somebody like Deepak Chopra got up and described the feel-bad rainbow. And I thought that was hilarious. The feel-bad rainbow. And here I see I've written a note, the feel-bad rainbow. And here's the sentence that I call the feel-bad rainbow. The therapeutic treatment Aryadeva advocates calms all who are disturbed by the fear of death, angered by painful feelings, tormented by sexual desires, and afflicted by arrogance. I love that because who isn't that? And wouldn't we like to not be that? Why are we like that? If indeed you are like that. I can only talk for my own self. I'm like that. And Aryadeva wants to say that the basic cause of this feel-bad rainbow, the basic cause is illusory perception of the world around us. And the way that the perceptions are illusory come into four main categories, although they can all be collapsed into the final one. So the first is thinking of things that are impermanent as permanent. These are concepts that we have. We think things that are actually impermanent, we see them as permanent. For instance, myself, my life. Just to mention one example, I kind of think my life is permanent. And Tsongkhapa himself says that this conception, that thinking that you are not going to die today, is the main obstacle to religious practice. Heck, I'm not going to die today. Why should I practice religiously? It's hard to practice religion. I could just as easily be, doing something else. The second illusion that Chandrakirti wants to talk about is considering the pure, that which is impure, to be pure. And mainly he wants to talk about the human body in this regard. The sexual desires that, if you're like me, you have, those sexual desires are based on a concept of purity, right? You're not thinking that that the object of your desire is disgusting. You wouldn't desire him or her. But of course the Buddhists, not just Tibetan Buddhists, but Buddhism from every corner of the world, wants to talk about the human body as a pretty horrible thing. A bag of pus and shit. And with my cold, I totally can see that. And there's a little problem here. If you're an academic like me and you're teaching these kinds of things in classrooms, you have to warn kids that you're going to talk about this kind of thing. And you also have to make, although the Tibetan, the Indian texts only speak of women as having disgusting bodies, as you might imagine, because those texts are written by men. Really, there's no difference in disgustingness between women and men, or for that matter, women, men, and cows. Have you ever opened up a cow? You will not eat steak if you've opened up a cow. I don't know how much shit is in a cow, but a tremendous amount comes pouring out when you slice a dead cow open. It's enough to turn you off from meat, and so that should be enough to put a damper on your sexual desires. But I don't want to go into that too much because nobody wants to hear that, really. But we think that that which is impure is pure. I had a lama once. He was the abbot of Loseling. I mean, he wasn't a joker. He was the most serious man I've ever met. And he lived in my house for a while, and he'd sit down next to me over the dinner table, and he'd take a big mouthful of food, and he'd open his mouth and show it to me. Because I'm kind of fat, so I like food. And he'd go, he was just trying to teach me a lesson. The lesson being that the food that I think is pure is that stuff that he was chewing, and it looked disgusting. We could talk about that a lot, and I'm sure that you have your own feelings about purity and impurity, but that's not our main point tonight. The third of the illusions is thinking that that which is painful is pleasurable. And don't we do that all the time? We think that which is painful, in reality, is pleasurable. Drugs, I'm thinking. I'm thinking about drugs. Because today I've been, you know, real sick, and I thought, God, I wish I had some drugs. But in fact, drugs are bad for your kidneys and so forth, and can anything that you try to take to relieve your pain can turn against you. Here in Portland, I see that marijuana is extremely popular, and that's cool. It's all over the world, it's extremely popular. Why is it popular? Because we think it's pleasurable. Perhaps in the short term it is pleasurable, but eventually it'll rip your throat out, right, and clog up your lungs, and you'll die horribly coughing up the stuff. All phenomena, all products are impermanent. All products are impermanent. And therefore, none of them really gives any lasting pleasure. But we conceive of that as, we conceive of so many things as being pleasurable. We conceive of many, many things as being pure. We conceive of other things as being permanent when in fact they're impermanent. And what is the basis of all of this wrong thinking? Why do we think that way? Arya Davis says that if we didn't think that way, the feel bad rainbow would go away. If we agreed that there was no pure sexual activity, you know, that might help the feel-bad rainbow. If we agreed that everything was impermanent, we might not fear death. If we had, since childhood, known that we were going to die and had it internalized, we'd have been preparing for it all this time. But nobody ever prepares for death, except Tibetan lamas. Why? Why are these illusions so solid? And that's because of the fourth one, the belief that that which has no self actually has a self. That's the basis of all the other illusions. We feel that everything has a self, when really a little analysis can show us that things don't have a self, at least not the kind of self that we think they have. Self can be divided into persons and phenomena other than persons. We feel something about our own self, which is wrong, and we feel something about the self of phenomena other than us, which is also wrong. And the kinds of, there are different kinds of selves that we do not exist, which we believe in. And then there is one kind of self that does exist, which we don't believe in. So let's go through that a little bit, because that's ironic. And I like Buddhism a lot because of its the deep irony to be found in it. The irony causes pain, but it's interesting. The first kind of self that Tibetans want to talk about is not an innate feeling, but it is... It's learned, and this is a self which is permanent, partless, and ducting, an essential, has an essence. A permanent, partless self with an essence. As if a permanent self, right? As if, and partless, that's how we think about ourselves if we're not being very thoughtful. As if you could cut me open and it'd be like a carrot through and through, one thing, not parts. We have that feeling about the self. Another type of self that we believe in is a self which is substantially existent. And a substantially existent self is the kind of self that doesn't depend on anything else. We believe that about ourselves. Substantially existent. We also believe things other than people are substantially existent. And we have special feelings about things other than people. We believe that they are the bases of names by way of their own character. And if you look around, this only has to do with phenomena other than people. If you look around at things, cup, chair, so forth, everything has a name. We've given everything a name. And perhaps due to that endless naming that we like to do, things look like they are the bases of those names by way of their own character. As if chair, the word chair came with the thing. Have you ever thought about that? It looks to me like cup comes with this thing, but cup is just a name that we give to that thing. It doesn't exist as the basis of a name. There's no need to give it a name, really. It could be fine without a name. Although nothing, we don't let anything go without a name. And so the name is part of the illusion of self, at least for phenomena other than us. But those are very coarse feelings about self. Those are very coarse feelings. And not at all the root of the problem. The root of the problem is believing that the self is inherently existent. And inherent existence is a funny thing. Of course, there is no such thing. Inherent existence is what we believe in, though. Inherent existence is the way things look to us, because if something is inherently existent, it's independent. It doesn't depend on its parts. It doesn't depend on its causes and conditions. And it doesn't depend on anyone imputing it as a whatever it is, a chair or whatever. Whereas really, in reality, those three kinds of dependence, the Buddha says, are for all phenomena, except for permanent phenomena, but we're not going to get into that. And you can tell if you're thinking something is inherently existent because it looks like one thing. It doesn't look like a conglomeration of parts. It looks like one thing, and it covers its parts. Have you ever considered that the table or the chair is made out of many, many different parts, but when you walk into a room and look at it, you only see one thing? Unless you're thinking analytically, right? You only see one thing. You see a chair that covers its parts. In the Prasangika Madhyamaka system, it's equally illusory for the external phenomena and for internal and for the self. We believe that, they say that we believe that all of these phenomena that we see, you can get rid of it. And the way to get rid of it, of course, is through meditation. I brought another book here. This is my favorite book, really. Chandrakirti's Sevenfold Reasoning by Joe Wilson. Joe Wilson was my first Tibetan teacher at the University of Virginia. And unlike most academics, Joe couldn't wait to get out of the classroom and meditate. And so now he's in Crestone, Colorado. Have you ever been there? Crestone, Colorado? And he's got long hair. He's a yogi. He's in Crestone, Colorado. That's an amazing place.
Which temple?
I guess there's a Geluk temple there, but it may be a Dzogchen temple. The great completeness. And in this book, Joe outlines what kinds of selves do not exist, and we've gone through that a little bit. And he wants to then talk about a self that does exist, and then he wants to explain how you can get rid of the illusion of a self. Now, Chandrakirti says that we do have a self, and it is a name given to the five aggregates. So here I have five aggregates. I've got my form, I've got consciousness, I've got feelings, I've got discriminations, I've got a miscellaneous grab bag of stuff. These are the five aggregates. And it's like holding five different things in your hand. If I had five pens, I usually like to use magic markers. If I had five magic markers, I'd hold them up and I'd give them a name. George, usually. I've done this before. George. And that's the self of those five pencils. A name given to them, George. So that exists, right? There's not much there, but it does exist. And here I'm, my five aggregates, and my parents called me Bill. Cool. But I have never once in my entire life felt that that was myself. What have I felt was myself? Well, that's an interesting question, and it varies from person to person. Who you think you are? Just who do you think you are? Joe used to say that the best way to identify the self that you incorrectly think you are is by waiting for an opportunity to come along where someone accuses you of something you have not done. Have you ever been accused of something that you have not done?
I have.
Or even of something I have done. Even that brings the self that I feel I am right up to the top. And at times like that, you can identify it quite readily. It's different from anyone, everyone. Joe used to say that for him, it was a golden column inside his body. But for me, I think it's the shape of my parts. That seems to be what I focus on. And it can change. It doesn't have to be one thing, because you remember, it's complete nonsense. So it can be basically anything that your crazed mind decides itself. But it needs to be identified. This is the first important point in Madhyamaka practice. Identify what you think you are. Or get a sense of what that is, at least. It's going to be something that has no parts. It's going to be something that's pure and permanent inside of you. It's a complete illusion. How do we determine that? I mean, why would you believe the Buddha when he says the self is a complete illusion? We've gone through all these years on earth knowing that we have that self, because people point at us and talk about us, and we feel that self. And then we need to protect it, and it's just been a mess. But there are ways to prove that it doesn't exist. Chandrakirti likes to use the example of a chariot. There's no difference in selflessness in the prasangika system between the person and other phenomena. No difference at all. All things are exactly the same, empty of inherent existence. Everything in the universe exists that way. So, we search for inherent existence. We search for it. Inherent existence has a variety of identifiable attributes that don't exist, but which are always present with an inherently existent self. First is independent. There's no dependence on other phenomena. If something is inherently existent, it did not depend on its causes. It did not require parts, and so forth. Something that is inherently existent doesn't change. It's solid. In order to change, you have to have parts, causes, that kind of thing. We don't believe that we have that. We feel we have an inherently existent self. It would always have existed, because since it didn't have any dependencies, nothing created it. Nothing could have created it. It always existed. Do you have something like that inside of you that you feel is in there? If you do, Chandrakirti says that's an illusion. How to root it out? That's the question. How to root it out? Because if you root it out, then you have realized, at least to a degree, emptiness and selflessness, and you have really made progress. The self that we believe in, which does not exist, is either going to be the same as the aggregates or different. There's no inexpressible third way. Although some Buddhist schools try to assert, early Buddhist schools, an inexpressible self existing in an inexpressible way with the person. But that was long ago. Those are the Pudgalavadins, and I don't think anyone practices them anymore. So there are two possibilities. Either that self that we feel we have is the same as our aggregates, or it's different from our aggregates. Or in some way, it's inherently dependent on the aggregates, or the aggregates may be inherently dependent on the self. Those kinds of things we have feelings about. Or the aggregates may be, or the self may be the shape of the aggregates, or the self may be, and by the aggregates I mean parts, or the self may be the collection of the parts. Those are possibilities. But basically, they come down to two. Either the self you believe in is the same as the aggregates, or it's different. Those are the two. Now, both of those positions are impossible. You cannot have an inherently existent self being the same as the aggregates, because there are five aggregates. And if the self was the same as the aggregates, there'd be five selves. Or, if you just want one self, there's only going to be one aggregate. To be the same as the self you believe you are, those logical problems will apply. We are five different aggregates. If the self is the same as the aggregates, there's no getting around that there are five of them. Or, if there's just one, if we want to assert there's just one, and they are the same as the aggregates, then we're going to have to believe there's only one aggregate. There's no way you can have a self that's the same as the aggregates unless you posit something like the self exists. Existing within the aggregates, like a lion roaming through a forest. This is another possibility. It's all about how you perceive this thing that doesn't exist. Do you want it to be the same? Do you want it to be different? Any way you want it to be, it's illogical.
But couldn't you say like colors? So if you take some acrylic paints, so you've got five different colors of paint, put them all together into a hole, mix it up, then you have brown, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Which is one thing. Would you say that the parts being together make one thing, like a collection?
Yes, the collection, that's one of the possibilities. That the self is the collection of the aggregates. Let's talk about bicycle instead. Chariot. Usually I talk about a bicycle, and I draw this on the board. I don't really know what a chariot looks like, so I use bicycles. Bicycles have many, many, many parts. Many parts. And yet when we look at a bicycle, we only see one thing. Hey, there's my bike. We don't say, hey, there's my collection of 1,500 precisionally engineered parts. We don't say that. We don't see that. So let's think maybe the self of the bicycle is the collection of its parts. That makes a lot of sense because when they're collected right, they give a shape which looks like a bicycle. So the shape of the parts and the collection of the parts are very similar. However, the bicycle can be dismantled and piled up in a different way, and that's the collection of its parts as well. And really, if the parts are the same as the self, there are going to be many selves, no matter whether it's a collection or a shape. It's all very illogical. And when you first start to get into this kind of reasoning, you resist it. You resist it. You think, and that's good, you want to resist it. Begin thinking how you feel about your own self. That's the first step, identifying it. And once you've identified it as either the same as the aggregates or different from the aggregates, you can apply the many reasonings that make both of those possibilities absurd. You can identify both of those, all of those reasonings that are written about extensively in the literature, in English these days. But I want to make a very important point, and I think it's dangerous to think about selflessness sometimes. It's dangerous because you might conclude that you don't have a self, or that the name given to your aggregates isn't much of a self, and that's nothing. But that's not nothing. That's who we are, and we need to come to terms with it. Other schools besides Madhyamaka, Prasangika Madhyamaka, will assert that the mental consciousness is the person. The person. And that may be helpful to think about. And I highly recommend cultivating, if you're feeling that you're ever losing yourself in the meditation on selflessness, that's not cool. You don't want to do that at all. Fall back to the position where your mental consciousness is the person. That might help. In general, talking about selflessness is a dangerous thing, and really, I'm not exaggerating. I have seen it have consequences on people who weren't ready for it. So usually it's important to talk about dependent arising first, and I should have done that if I'd had 2 days. First, one wants to talk about, this is the Buddhist way, one wants to talk about what exists because so much exists. And then one wants to talk about what doesn't exist. Because the belief in what doesn't exist is a superimposition, and superimpositions are illusory. illusory. This kind of meditation is for people of advanced abilities, and you very well may be those people. I just don't know. Chandrakirti says, I love reading Chandrakirti. Chandra means moon. He's the Reverend Moon. Chandrakirti says, if you're a person of small abilities like me, then you should practice generosity. I love that, because a person of small abilities wants to be reborn in a high status. That's how small my abilities are. King, sure, I'd like to be king next life. Not really, I'm just... A person like that, though, needs to practice generosity, because in your next life, you will be wealthy. There's a Tibetan saying about it. Jinbe longche trim gide. Through the practice of giving, resources will come to you. Through the practice of ethics, happiness will come to you. Through the practice of patience, beauty will be yours. A person of middling capabilities wants his or herself to be released from cyclic existence. None of this bodhisattva stuff, just get me out of here. And that kind of person should practice patience. Now, the word patience is really unfortunate, I think. Patience, to me, means you're sitting in an airplane and you're trying not to scream because you've been there for hours. That's not what is meant in Buddhism by patience. In fact, the word should be forbearance. Persons of middling capacities should practice forbearance. Forbearance means that no matter what kind of obstacles are in your path, you are not going to turn aside. It's a lot more profound than patience. Patience means you can sit around waiting for the dentist for a couple hours, right? Anybody can do that. Working through a lifetime of obstacles for the betterment of others, that's forbearance. And finally, if you're a bodhisattva, you should practice tranquility. Tranquility is also called calm abiding, and that will lead to meditation on emptiness. So I see it's 8:30, and probably I've said enough, so let's have questions. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer them. Sir?
I think I missed one of the four classes of illusions earlier. You said that there was one that which is impermanent is permanent. One was that which is painful is pleasurable. One is that which is impure is pure. What was the fourth?
That which is no self is considered to be self.
Okay.
Yeah, I bet I didn't state that. Yeah, thank you. And that's the root, and the root of cyclic existence is the is conception of an inherently existent self, as far as the talk about is concerned. So cyclic existence is just hanging by a thread. You can destroy it. I highly recommend that. Somebody's got to do it. Things are getting out of hand. Any questions about anything at all having to do with Buddhism? I'm happy to spitball, even if I don't know the answer.
How about permanent, unitary, and purpose? That sounds like a soul. So is it sort of
I'm sorry, say it again.
Permanent, the first level, the course level, permanent part of the self.
Yes, the permanent part of the self. Yes, the, I'm not sure that it describes the Atman, but the Atman is definitely this, any kind of soul in Catholicism or other religions is going to be a separate from the aggregates. And a self that you conceive of as separate from the aggregates is learned. You're not born with that. We're born with believing that the self is somehow the same as the aggregates. That's our innate belief. And so religions teach, for better or worse, teach souls and selves that are other than the aggregates. I'm thinking of my Catholic youth.
So I have two daughters. One's 7, one's almost 3. And the almost 3-year-old is definitely going through some fascinating, challenging, hunting for self, or, you know, all sorts of kind of, you know, asserting the most bizarre things all the time, left and right, which is why I'm here, you know, for a little bit of quiet. And, so my question, that was kind of a vague entryway, but what kinds of, what sorts of, like, self might she be exploring, you know, when she's trying, you know, she'll describe things that are, I wonder if you have any thoughts on, like, what can you learn about the self through a almost 3-year-old boy?
Can you tell me, how does she describe what she's thinking about?
She'll say things like tonight, right before I left, she was sort of like, those are your underpants. Now, where are your new underpants? You know, sort of, she'll grab onto these certain things, kind of really, you know, so like she's putting together this, she's like navigating this world. And occasionally she'll fly onto the floor and go wild, you know, as if some, this is, maybe the question, another question is like, how does this relate to Buddhism, you know? I thought I'd throw it out there. Top of my mind these days.
I hear you. It would be on the top of my mind too. Children are amazing, aren't they? And they come with a full set of obsessions from a previous life. If you wanted to jump in, the Buddha, when he encounters children, of course, doesn't talk about selflessness. He talks about a Buddha within, a Buddha inside. I don't know if the context, in the context of your family life, you'd want to bring that up, but I think children are happier with something, a self, a Buddha nature is a very nice thing to have, like a soul, right? And it does exist, so it's not a lie. It doesn't exist the way you might want it to exist as a Buddha inside, the Gaelic say. Although other Buddhist traditions feel there is a Buddha inside. I don't know, it sounds like your daughter's awfully smart.
I know she is, yeah.
Smart people are analytical. And without logic training, that analysis kind of is free-floating sometimes. Maybe that's what's going on with her.
Yeah, it's pretty fascinating.
Yeah. How about your older one?
She's equally fascinating. In first grade, and her, it's like has her own sets of things that she's working through, but she's great. They're both great.
Sure, of course.
It's just kind of consistent, whoa.
Well, they're lucky kids. They've got you as a dad.
Thanks. Thank you.
Just.
I heard you just say a comment that I hear often about intelligence and logic and being analytical and how that's so important. Yet, also, I feel a very strong connection with emotion and heart-based sense of connection. How do you balance that? So I have a very strong emotional response to someone in suffering, but should I be more, I don't know how to be disconnected. It's not very analytical if I'm having a very heartfelt response to someone in some respect. So,
yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying?
I do. Mm-hmm.
I have a hard time with Buddhism because it seems like I'm not very elevated because I'm so heart-based in my response. And I'm very emotional. So how can I be very analytical?
Oh, that's such a good question. I don't see any problem. I think you should be heart-based. That's your compassionate aspect. And yet, there are matters to be resolved that cannot be resolved only with the heart. And look at Rinpoche. Rinpoche? Look at Rinpoche. That man is all heart, and yet he debated in a savage competition for 25 years. But he's all heart. And you can be that way too. On the other hand, Buddhism is not the only religion that's good for a person with heart. There's the Sufi religion, I think, that, you know, their emblem is a heart with wings. That's a beautiful thing. You don't have to be just a Buddhist, right? You can be a variety of things. Not always asserting this, but it seems like you can, here we are in America, we can have a kind of a supermarket approach to spirituality, whatever fits you. But generally they say that the Geluks, the Dalai Lama and so forth, says that a kind heart is the basis for an evolving analytical approach to reality. You don't want to analyze yourself out of giving, although you do want to give with an analytical mind, thinking, I am empty, this act of giving is empty, and the recipient is empty. That might swell your heart even more. Heart is a big part of Buddhism, a big part. We only have one goal in Buddhism, and that's helping others. Only one goal. So you can't do that with an analyst. I had Geshe's that I studied with who I thought were cold-hearted bastards. So really. Really. I don't know why they were monks. I couldn't figure it out. But the ones I loved and learned from the most were big, loose-limbed Kamba Geshe's who just had overflowing with love. How does a man get that way? Meditation. And meditation is analytical for the most part. Anybody want to say anything more? This is an interesting point, right? We're all in there.
There are other schools that are not necessarily so analytical.
Mm.
For instance, the Maitripa College school, don't focus.
watching your breath, more of a practice based than thinking analytical based.
That's true, and there are Pure Land schools. But even early Buddhism had vipassana, you know, the analytical meditation having that went along with shamatha. So it is kind of an integral part of Buddhism. I highly recommend if any of you don't like parts of Buddhism, just, you know, put them aside. What the heck? There's no boss in Buddhism, I've noticed. That's one of the reasons I like it.
Wasn't that heard you just say that analytical meditation is really, it also is emotional. Like, you know, so you get a lot of power. Like, that would definitely hurt. And then you have a analysis, and then super personal, that's when the transformation happens. So it's like, it has that part of emotion.
Analysis to be critical of people pretty effectively, and then everybody will hate you and you will hate them. So I think Sunita's really right on. Well said. Yeah.
That's quite a lot. But the other thing that I like, wisdom, that, you know, this no self aspect. The one thing that I find really inspiring is, you know, one way of describing is like, it's like removing all the weeds so that your compassion can blossom. Because having a strong sense of ego is actually an obstacle. So in some ways you're kind of creating that space to kind of remove this illusory self, because in some ways that's blocking this limitless potential that we have in ourselves. That's what it is. You know, you can be omniscient, you can, you know exactly what the other person needs.
I wonder if you could talk about Buddha nature some more.
Yeah, Buddha nature, Tathagata Garba. The word Garba means womb. Tathagata is the Buddha. So the Buddha nature is not really, we don't, in the Uma Institute where I work, we no longer say Buddha nature. We say, Hopkins has this hilarious thing. The matrix of the one God thus. He saw that movie, The Matrix?
Yeah.
He loved it. So, the Buddha nature, in Tibet there were three theories about the Buddha nature. One, and the Buddha nature is an important teaching. It's not the central teaching of Tibetan Buddhism, but it's always important. The Buddha nature was considered to be a teaching, you know, it was a positive teaching. It was good for children. It was good for those who were new and didn't, hadn't generated their facilities. The Buddha nature is either the mind of a Buddha, that's one theory, or it's the mind of someone who has not yet become a Buddha, that's Budun's theory, or it is the emptiness of the mind of one who has not yet become a Buddha, and that's Tsongkhapa's theory. So, however, there are other non-Geluk trips about the Buddha nature in which there is a Buddha inside of you. The Jonang in particular, other emptiness, here we are in a Gelug Dharma Center, right? So probably the other schools of Tibet have not been discussed quite as much as they should be. But they're very popular in Tibet. And one of them is called Jonang, in which inside everyone there is a beautiful Buddha, completely enlightened, all the beauty, the marks and beauties, deep inside. And you have to work, your Buddhist practice is to get rid of all the gunk that you have defiled that Buddha with until you're digging down like into a buried treasure. Very popular in Tibet. Gelugs dislike it, but it's very popular. So there are lots of different Buddha nature theories in Buddhism. But the one that our Rinpoche will subscribe to, I feel, is that it is the emptiness of the mind of someone who has not yet become a Buddha. And when you become a Buddha, the emptiness of the mind becomes the nature body of the Buddha. So it's a continuum.
Is it fair to say that that's like saying the potential to become a Buddha?
Yes, that's exactly what it is.
I've been struggling with four concepts, just kind of trying to put them together, and they seem somewhat contradictory. And maybe you could help with this. So thinking about karma, I'm thinking about the concept of a self or a no self. I'm thinking about non-duality and the mind stream. So they'll talk about karma as being specific to a particular person.
Discrete, yes.
And that it continues from life to life. So there's something that continues from life to life.
Yes.
It seems to be individual, because my karma is not your karma.
True.
So there's some duality there, even though that's not the nature of reality. But so I don't quite understand. Perhaps the mind stream could be considered in a way a sort of an individual self, not like a story self, but like an existent thing.
There are schools, schools in Buddhism that assert that the mind stream is an illustration of the person, is the illustration of the person. They don't assert it as a self, because Buddhists don't assert a self, but the illustration of the person. Gelugs don't assert that. Gelugs assert that your karma is carried along to your next life through imputation, the way everything exists. And imputation is just thought processes. Pardon me. Not much exists outside of thought processes in Gelug Buddhism. Even though they do assert external objects, they don't assert them very strongly.
So the mind stream is a group of thoughts?
The mind stream is a continuum of moments of mental acuity, not thoughts necessarily. The mind is the definition of mind in Buddhism is clear and knowing. And it proceeds in a continuum of moments. As far as non-duality is concerned, duality is a big part of Buddhism. There's lots of duality in Buddhism. And your karma is in your mind stream to with you. That's where the imputations happen. So when you die, something very subtle will go to the next life. This is a tantric thing, right? At the moment of death, suddenly they want to talk about tantra and the small seeds of consciousness that go to your next life. And yet, even though they're immaterial, just mental, they have this tremendous effect on your next life.
That sounds like a self. That sounds like a unit. Right? It sounds like a unit of something that's not the unit, you know, over here, right?
There is a self, you'll recall, the name given to the five aggregates. that moves from the next to the next. That's called the mirror eye, not some. And the mirror eye moves to the, from one life to the next. It's not much, but it's all they want to posit. It's all they want to assert. I don't know what the truth of that matter is, but...
How is that not a self?
It is a self. It is a self, but it's not an inherently existent self. Mm-hmm. There is a self, right? We do have a self.
Like saying two rivers are distinct, but they're flowing, changing, constantly flowing. So there's a self in that we name a river, the Mississippi, but it's not inherently Mississippi.
As long as it's not inherently existent, we do have a self. Yeah, here we are, each of us individual.
Well, that's a conventional self. But
yes.
The ultimate self is different.
Yeah, we don't have an ultimate self.
So you're saying the mind stream and the karma attached to it is the conventional self, or a representation of the conventional self?
The karma deposits seeds in the mind stream. That's not the self, because the self is just, that's only one aggregate, the mind stream. The self is a name given to, the real self that we have, is a name given to all of the aggregates. I know, that doesn't sound like much, right?
Can the mind stream come to an end?
This is a big debate. Those who feel like nirvana can be attained by severing their mental and physical continuum assert that the mind stream can come to an end. However, Dharmakirti says that it cannot come to an end because the previous moment of mind creates its next moment endlessly. So the best you can do with a mind stream, which is something of a mixed blessing, is to become a Buddha with it, according to the Tibetans. They don't think that the mind can be stopped.
So the Buddhas are separate from each other? The Buddhas are separate from each other. Some other thing.
This is really interesting. This is the kind of thing they like to debate. The Buddhas are separate from each other, but they all know the same stuff, right? And they have no personalities, really, except stuff they create to be helpful. Correct. At least that's what they say.
Are you equating the mind stream with the mental aggregate?
Yeah, consciousness.
Isn't it a separate thing?
No, consciousness is in the mind stream. We're talking about the same thing. Consciousness in a continuum is the mind stream. Well, what else could it be?
I've just heard there's a subtle level of mind that is not an aggregate. It's not the mental aggregate. It's a different thing.
Not in Gaelic Buddhism. No. Not in Gaelic Buddhism. Yeah. There are tantric trips, right? That even the Dalai Lama will sometimes fall into, but usually they like to keep Tantra and Sutra separate, talk about them separately, and I certainly like to do that because Tantra is a dangerous topic. I always tell people about the dangers of Buddhism. And this is because I used to run a Dharma center and I've seen the dangers become manifest. But I bet there are schools at a sort of subtle level of mind. Well, like, for instance, the Nyingma. Don't they assert a Rigpa, which is like a basic mind, which is not the mental continuum? I'm not sure. You can find lots of things in Tibetan Buddhism. There are many different traditions. There's no unifying tradition in Tibetan Buddhism. thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure. I hope this is the kind of public talk that you kind of felt you deserve. I hope so.
Thank you.
Thank you.